All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. This is the 6th annual Robert McMillan Graduate Research and Education Symposium. My name is Irene Melagiotis.
And I'm Jenna Larusso.
And we are both the elected steering committee members for the symposium committee this year. So it is our pleasure to welcome you, and we are so excited for what the day has to bring. Just a little bit about the symposium, in case you're not aware of the background. In 2009, three doctorate students, Wendy Crocker, Zhao Xiaodu, and Jordana Garbati, who have since graduated from the Faculty of Education, conceptualized the symposium. And with the support and guidance of Dr. Robert Bob McMillan, the then Associate Dean of Graduate Programs and Research, the first Graduate Research and Education Symposium was held in April 2010. And while initially it was conceived as a forum for graduate students within the faculty to showcase their research, in 2013, the symposium committee decided to expand and include all research from graduate students across other faculties and departments in Western. After the sad news of his passing in 2012, the symposium was renamed in 2013 in honor of Dr. McMillan's pivotal contributions to make the symposium a reality. So that's where we stand today, and we're very happy to welcome you to continue this very important tradition in our faculty.
We want to draw your attention to the schedule, which is in your program also, so you'll always have a copy of it. Right after opening remarks, the dean will be speaking, and then we'd invite you all to go over to room 1162, which is just around the corner, and we're going to have a really exciting panel discussion with the Faculty of Education's own Katina Pollack, maybe she can wave, and Bill Tucker, and Western's Candace Burnett Dabasagi. Also, they're going to be talking about equitable education. And then we invite you to come back to the community room, and we're going to have all the posters set up for a poster reading session, as well as a refreshment break. At that time, there's a change in the schedule. At that time, we're going to be doing the door prize draw, as well as the Best of Symposium poster awards. So just a note, if you haven't submitted your coupon portion of your ticket, please do that, because that will make you eligible for the door prize. And you just submit it right over there in that beautiful box with the yellow sticky note.
With the yellow sticky note.
After that, we're going to have two back-to-back sessions of paper roundtables in various rooms on the upper and lower level of the faculty. Again, the specific room numbers are in the detailed program. And then we invite you to join us for some really brief closing remarks, again, in 1162. All right, just to let you know, if you have any questions, please see one of our very friendly committee members, and they'll have this Ask Me badge, okay? If you experience any issues with technology in your rooms, mostly pertaining to the virtual presentations and paper presentations, please contact Mike Harris, and his cell phone number, I believe, was distributed to all moderators. If not, please come see me, and I will give that to you. If you want access to the presentations on the second floor, you can go up to the stairs on this side of the faculty near the education library. Just follow the signs. All rooms will have a trifold with a poster board outside indicating which sessions will be held in those rooms. And just a gentle reminder again, please submit your comments sheet for us, because this is the way that we can grow our symposium. We want to improve every year, so tell us what you liked about it and what you think we can do better next year. Also, if you haven't already done so, if you are willing to allow us to take your picture and use it for advertising purposes on our symposium website for next year's symposium committee, please sign your photo release form. If you do not want us to photograph you, make sure you have a red sticker on your badge so we are aware of who you are. We can avoid taking a picture of you. Big thank you to our donor sponsors and supporters. Mr. Tom Seth is a representative of Cambridge University Press. He has his table set up there. I encourage you to go over and visit him and say hi, see the wonderful products that he has available. Mr. Bear Bergman is an author. He donated several books for us to give away as door prizes. And Greg Marshall, elementary teacher in the Thames Valley District School Board, is the winner of our cover photo contest. We want to thank their contributions. As well, within the Western University, we have several facets that have been instrumental to allowing us to offer you what we are offering today. The Alumni Association has donated some
several things: Canadian Research Center for Inclusive Education, e-learning technology center, most specifically, allowing us to offer our workshops over the past few months online and to update our symposium. The Faculty of Education Library also has a board out there that you can peruse, and they're also open until 7 p.m. today, so I welcome you on a break to go visit them and say hi. The Graduate Postgraduate Studies Office, the Pre-Service Education Office, the Society of Graduate Professional Students, and the Faculty of Education Research Office that has provided us with the majority of the funding that has allowed for this symposium to be a reality today. So thank you very much to our donor sponsors and supporters. I ask you to give them a big round of applause.
We also want to thank our committee members. So I'm going to read out everyone's name. If you wouldn't mind standing briefly, and that way we can acknowledge you and people know who to come to for questions. So Heather Crowe, if she's in the room or she might be working. She's working? Okay, there you go. They're working hard. Abby Dugal, working also. Eva Jabari. Michael Carras. Diana Cool. Alicia LaPointe. Mary Ott. Jane Chi. Caroline Verrett.
Hi, everybody.
Annette Walker. Caitlin Watson, Wei Wei, and Chi Wu, and Zara Zabarsday. And I would also like to acknowledge the chair, Irene. She has done an incredible amount of work, and I'd like for us all to give everyone a big round of applause.
Really, it's a team effort when it comes to something like this, so I had an amazing team to work with this year, as with last year, but every year is different. And I just wanted to thank every single person who decided they would volunteer their time, especially first-year students who are amidst their coursework, their very heavy coursework. So thank you to everybody. And again, we're really happy that you're here. And we're so excited with the array of presentations we have to offer for you.
At this time, I'd like to welcome the dean, Dr. Vicky Schwein.
Very appropriate today that you have a research day, because we in the Faculty of Education had the most wonderful news this morning around the research. We had 15 SHRC Insight Development Grants were awarded at Western, and we heard about it late last night. And out of the 15 awarded to Western, 4 of them came to faculty members in the Faculty of Education. That's unheard of. So I have to also underscore, I'll give you the names of the 4 winners. Wayne Martino received one in, I think, about $240,000. Elizabeth Nowicki, $190,000. Rachel Hayden, $240,000. And Jackie Specht, $489,000. The largest SHRC grant that came to Western University this year. So we are moving on up. Yes?
And a fifth one just got announced. Katina Pollock.
She did?
Yes.
How did that get
in? Just hot off the press.
Hot off the... It just keeps getting better. Oh my goodness. We are so firmly determined that this faculty will outstrip UBC, which is currently number one, and I think we're well on the way to doing that. So it's very appropriate that we have today's research in the next generation, I hope, of scholars who, if you're not at Western, you'll be somewhere else shining brightly. I'm going to introduce to you the individual that has had a lot to do with this particular symposia that's held. Catherine, would you stand up? Catherine is the widow of Robert McMillan, and she has been such a fundamental member of our Faculty of Education for many years, and I thank you for your ongoing support of this symposium, Catherine. It's really wonderful. room looks amazing. You did an amazing job, and I hear that Carolyn, where did she go?
She's in the other room working. Carolyn!
If anyone is looking to hire a decorator, I suggest that they give you a call. The room looks beautiful.
Thank you.
Irene, you did an awesome job, and Jenna, and all of the committee. This is such a wonderful grouping of young scholars. It's lovely to be here and to see you join as a community to look at your research together. So thank you from me. This is really incredible. I'm sorry that our Associate Dean of Research isn't here today. He's in England doing research at the moment. But on his behalf, I would just say again, you've just done us proud, no question about it. You know, research is so important to young scholars. Most of you are in research-intensive programs, and that's why you're doing a thesis or a dissertation. And that research or dissertation has two significant outcomes at the end of the day. One of them has to do with changing the world. The other has to do with changing you. And from experience, anyone who is sitting here as a faculty member will understand what I'm saying when I say changing you. But changing the world. I think that one of the advantages in being in a professional faculty, like a faculty of education, or any professional faculty, is that your research, regardless of whether you're in a professional program, doctoral program, and we are very, very happy that we have a doctorate of education here in the faculty in educational leadership, as well as our PhD and our MA degrees, you have the potential to do research that impacts the world. Rather than, you know, and I'm not putting down any other kind of research, but yours has a particular ability to change the lives of children, of communities, and of professionals in the field. And those are the kinds of changes that can have a long-lasting impact. When research is constructed, it's fundamentally important to make that research linked to the real world. It has to be authentic. It has to be relevant. And I would assume that 90% of what comes out this door is both of those things, authentic and relevant, because then it can be used. And how do we build authentic and relevant research? Well, you know all too well. You've studied a lot. You've developed a depth and breadth of your disciplinary area. I hope you've also developed a depth and breadth of research methodology and different techniques that allow you to examine really critical issues. I hope that you thought long and hard about how you're going to analyze your data. And importantly, how are you going to translate that data so that your community understands? And when you follow those basic rules, you will produce research that the next generation of professionals or scholars, young scholars like you, will be able to refer to that and continue to build in an incremental way on the great findings that you obtain. Nothing ever opened. You know, I remember as a PhD student, I did my PhD in psychology, and I remember thinking, oh, I'm going to produce research that's going to change the world in a big way. You know, it didn't. It didn't. Because research is built incrementally. And what you have to do in your research is excite the next generation to carry on where you left off. Don't think you're going to change the world because you'll be here till you're 108. We don't want to see you when you're 108. So change it incrementally, but change it thoughtfully, and change it with the right ethical and moral imperatives guiding you in that research. So the second thing is it will change you. And I can see immediately when I walk in this room how it is changing you. Not only does it change your brain, we're into neuroscience now, so we know that the more you read, and the more that you question, and the more that you interact with others, the more significantly your brain develops. And it continues to right throughout lifetime. We used to think it closed off and suddenly became stupid or something. But you don't. Your brain continues to evolve. And so all of the discussions that you have with your colleagues and all of the mistakes that you make along the way, and all of the things that you do right create new neural paths that allow you to become more critical and more evaluative in your kind of thinking that you do. That's a big part of our programs, is getting you to engage in critical thinking skills by having you face different lenses, asking you questions, asking you to think differently, to go outside the box, to think critically. And that changes your life in a pretty significant way. Your life also changes because of the relationships that you develop. I think that many of us remember going through our master's and doctoral program and retaining friendships that we developed years and years and years and years ago. We still keep in touch with those individuals. All of the PhD students I have supervised over three other universities continue to talk to me, continue to write with me, continue to consult with me. And I hope that you're not only developing those kinds of collegial relationships amongst your fellow scholars here, but with your mentors as well. And I hope also that you don't leave with only one mentor. It's very easy to get attached to one supervisor, but we know from lots and lots of research that the most critical scholars take the time to know lots of different mentors and have opportunities to pair with them in different kinds of research. I assume many of you will want to move into academic careers. How many? Oh, not so many. I thought there would be more. For those of you that hope you're going to move into academic careers, what you do in your master's thesis and your PhD dissertation will be so important, will be so fundamentally important when you try to move into an academic position. You will be asked, what is your passion? What is your interest? And how are you going to carry that forward in the next number of years? And I assume each and every one of you has found your passion in your research. But it doesn't have to stay forever. Again, your growing skills will allow you to mature and to take other topics under advisement. How many of you are going to professional careers then? And some of you just don't even want to work, huh? Those of you going into a professional career will have such a profound impact on what happens in whatever profession you're in, because you'll be one of the few individuals who does have the capacity to lead others in terms of quality changes to the environment in which you're working. And it is every bit as important an occupation as being a scholar. Whatever rocks your boat, right? So I congratulate you again. I'm sorry, I had anesthetic yesterday and my knees are knocking together. So I'm not going to be able to stay for the rest of your day, I'm very sorry. But I know that this will be so successful, and you know, it's such a wonderful opportunity. But you know, I think Catherine, you have to walk away and think, this is such a wonderful tribute and honor to Robert, because these students will, together with faculty members and who else is in attendance, have the opportunity discuss, to critique, to get other ideas, to really get excited about what they're doing, to present what they're doing with a passion that you know, we may not all understand. And they'll walk away with so many new learnings. And that's a wonderful thing to give anybody. So thank you again. So have a great, great symposium. And I look forward to some feedback from you, Irene, and how everything went. Thank you very much for inviting me, and have a great time.
Thank you, Dean Bingshun, for that wonderful and inspiring address. We won't take any more of your time. We want to ask for us all to migrate to room 1162. If you're unfamiliar about the building, you're going to go exit out these doors, make a right, go around the hall on the right as well, and it's on the right-hand side. You'll see that tri-fold with the poster board outside. And we look forward to seeing you in a very few minutes so we can start our discussion panel on equitable education. Thank you very much.